But since we didn't talk about the parables on Thursday night, I wanted to do it this morning, the parable of the two debtors. And this parable is so wonderful because it really strikes the truth about how we are to respond to our sin. How do you respond to your sin? Terry, I didn't ask you, are we good back there? Thank you. And we see here in Luke chapter 7, and this parable is nestled in a certain event. And to understand the parable, you have to see it in that context of the event. Luke chapter 7, verse 36. Now, one of the Pharisees was requesting him to dine with him. And he entered the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. Remember, in those days, many times they would almost be in a prostrate position with their legs out, kind of leaning on an elbow or half sitting up at the table. Everybody was seated on the floor. And there was a woman in the city who was a sinner. In the scriptures and in this culture, if you said so-and-so was a sinner, everybody kind of knew what you were talking about. You were talking about something immoral. You were talking about something illegal or criminal. When it involved a woman like this, more times than not, most of the times, it meant that she was a prostitute. And you have to remember, in these days, women didn't have jobs. They didn't have any means to earn income and to provide for their family. And there were many prostitutes who did not want to be prostitutes, but they were desperate, and it was their last resort. When you lost your husband, either through death or through infidelity, and now you were uncovered as a woman, you had no provision. You had to fend for yourself. And so, not in any way to excuse prostitution, I'm not saying that, but just realize many times these people are in desperate, desperate situations. It wasn't like today where a woman can go out and get a job and start to provide on her own. There was a woman in the city who was a sinner, most likely a prostitute. And when she learned that he was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster vial of perfume. And many times that vial out of alabaster was sealed. Sometimes it wasn't. Most of the time it was. This perfume would be the most costly thing they owned. Perfume like this was very expensive. And so to use it on anything else but a burial was highly unusual. You only brought it out for the most special or the most solemn occasions. And standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and kept wiping them with the hair of her head and kissing his feet and anointing them with the perfume. We don't know exactly what was going through her mind or heart, but somewhere, somehow, in her heart, she knew that this man was her Savior. And she felt so ashamed and so embarrassed and so condemned for her sins. And yet somehow she knew in her heart, this is the Savior. He can save me from my sins. Just fragments of faith that rose up in her heart. And she began to weep. Look at verse 38. Was that your reaction in worship this morning? I trust that it is. I know that it was for many of you. Hopefully all of us. But if that's not your reaction to Jesus as your Savior, then you really don't understand what you've been saved from. And we really need to understand what we've been saved from. And we need to understand that there is no hope from our sins except Jesus. He alone is our Savior. He died for us in our place. He set us free. He offers us free forgiveness and mercy. And without Him, we're doomed to die and to be in torture forever and ever in a hell where the flames and the worms never cease. Do you know what Jesus has saved you from this morning? If you really understand that you are incapable of saving yourself and that you must have a Savior, then verse 38 will be your reaction. That's how you love Him. That's how you worship Him. Now, when the Pharisee had invited him, saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who and what sort of person this woman is who is touching him. See, they believe they would, you know, when a Samaritan walked down the street, they would get on the other side. They wouldn't, they didn't want a sinner touching them. They believed that somehow that sin would be transferred through touch and that they would be defiled. He said, if this Jesus knew what sort of person this woman is, that she is a sinner, he must not be a prophet. He must not understand who and what she is. I love this about Jesus. Don't you love the Pharisee, verse 39, the Pharisee said this to himself. And what does Jesus do? Jesus calls him out, huh? And Jesus answered him, answered a private thought that was never spoken out loud. But Jesus knew what he was thinking. And he said, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he replied, say it, teacher. A moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. A denarius, I have there in your notes, it was about one day's wages. So one person owed 500 days' wages. How long would that take to pay off? And then the other just had 50, much more easier to manage. When they were unable to pay, he graciously forgave them both. I want you to know, whatever sins you've committed in your life, God wants to graciously forgive. And he wipes it away so that it's no longer on your account. And he takes away all of the condemnation and all of the guilt. He wants you to know how much he loves you and cherishes you. He wants you to know how he doesn't hold that to your account. And when he looks at you, he never ever sees that sin attached to your name. He just sees his child. He sees what the blood of Jesus has washed and cleansed. Aren't you glad to be free from your sins? Washed by the blood of the Lamb. He graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more? And Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you have judged correctly. Turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, which was customary for that day. She has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with perfume. For this reason I say to you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. Now, let me ask you a question. Was Simon forgiven little because he had little to forgive? Or was Simon forgiven little because he was sorry for little? What do you think? Simon needed forgiveness just as much as this woman, didn't he? And it wasn't because he had little to forgive, it was the fact that he was sorry for little. He was blind to his own need. And it's sad when Christians go through life full of self-righteousness and they're blind to how much they need Jesus, how much they need a Savior. They're blind to their own condition of their heart. And he said to her, your sins have been forgiven. Those who were reclining at the table with him began to say to themselves, who is this man who even forgives sins? He ignored it, and he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Forgiveness is free. Salvation is free. And when you realize the depth of your depravity and how desperately you need Jesus, when you receive that forgiveness and the clear conscience and the mercy and your relationship with him is restored, you'll worship Jesus the same way this lady did, this woman did. So what does God want from us? There's, you know, in this story we have two players. We have the sinful woman, and we have this Pharisee that on the outward would seem to have everything going for him. He's got his spiritual regulations in order. He's got his regimen tuned up. What does God really want from us? Psalms 51, verse 16. And remember this psalm. This is the psalm of David, of repentance after the sin with Bathsheba. And so he's praying here and he says, for you do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it. you are not pleased with burnt offering. And you think, well, why not, Lord? Because aren't you the one that instituted the offerings? And yes, God did institute the offerings, but God put into place the offerings to be a symbol, a type of the coming Jesus, the coming sacrifice. And the sacrifices were supposed to be something which pointed people's faith and mind to the Savior, the Lamb of God who would come and be slain on the cross. That was the purpose of the sacrifices, to show people what was to come. But being the men that we are, the women that we are, we pervert everything, right? And so instead of the sacrifice being a point of faith to the coming Jesus, we now take it and now, you know, it becomes a matter of self-will and pride and look what I did and look how spiritual I am. And, you know, I'm going to clean up my own mess and I'm going to fix this sin problem and God is going to be lucky to have me and I'm just going to stroll my way right into heaven because of all the good things that I've done. And so man twisted and perverted something that God put in place that was supposed to point people to Jesus, but we perverted it to become a thing of competition and pride. He says in verse 17, the sacrifices of God are what? A broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. You know, when you sin and when you fail, what does God want from you? He doesn't want a lot of religiosity. He wants your heart to be sorry. He wants you to be honest. All he wants from you is just to come to him and say, God, I am so sorry. I offended you. I hurt your heart. I'm so sorry for what I did. I come and I lay my sin upon the cross of Jesus Christ because I can't make it better. I can't fix it. I can't fix me. And so, Father, I'm coming with a broken heart, a needy heart. I need you. I need your help. And then when that forgiveness comes and you're assured of his love for you, just the gratitude that begins to flow out. God doesn't want a lot of religious rules. God doesn't want your good deeds to outweigh your bad deeds. God doesn't want a perfect performance. God wants your honest heart. He wants your broken heart. Just come and confess and he'll freely forgive. You all remember someone who used to come to our congregation a few years back, and in the line of duty, and somebody he told many of you this, in the line of duty, you know, he saved the life of a girl, but he never caught this faith thing about the scriptures and about giving it all to Jesus. And because his comment would be, and he said it to me a couple times, and I know he said it to many of you, and we all tried to encourage him in the right way to perceive our sin. But remember, he would say things like, well, you know, because I saved that girl's life, God has to let me into heaven. And we tried to tell him, it doesn't work that way. You don't buy your way into heaven. You don't work to be good enough to make it into heaven. You can never, never make it right with God. You can never fix the problem. You can never clean up the mess. That's what God does. Remember that passage in Ezekiel where he picks up the baby that was thrown out in the field and he washes away the blood and he washes away the filth, and that's all God's job. We can't do it. And he loves doing it. He loves caring for you in that way. Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit. Those that are broken and contrite before him. Blessed are those who know how much they need God. They don't try to fix it themselves. When you try to fix it yourself, you only make it worse. Blessed are those who lay it at the feet of Jesus, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. One of the things that, you know, you see in the church today that's, I think we really need to be on guard against, is the implementation of human methods in trying to rehabilitate someone. And people cannot be rehabilitated. They must be crucified on the cross of Jesus Christ, and they must be resurrected with the life that raised Jesus from the dead. And outside of that, there is no rehabilitation. Those that are poor in spirit. One thing, and I mention this, and I kind of hesitate to mention this because I'm not saying that I'm against it, but the big thing right now, especially with the curse of pornography? Are these accountability partners? You know, I just say you got to be careful, because your accountability partner didn't die for you. Your accountability partner didn't bear your sin. Your accountability partner cannot deliver you from the power and the addiction of that sin. Your accountability partner cannot set you free. It's Jesus and Jesus alone. And when you have a sin like that or any other sin, Jesus can come and change your heart so that you hate what you used to seek. And until that miracle intervention takes place, you're not delivered. All that accountability partner is doing is being your conscience temporarily. And in certain seasons of recovery, I agree, you probably need that. That's probably a good thing, but you better outgrow it. Because that accountability partner is not getting you into heaven. And he can't change your heart. And he can't change your desires. It better be you and Jesus, and you need to get on your knees and figure out that your only hope is in Jesus Christ alone. Blessed are the poor in spirit. They know how much they need God. I come and I bring my sins and I lay them at the feet of Jesus. I lay them at the cross, and God does a marvelous, miraculous work in me. How he does it, I can't explain. I don't know how, what happens, but somehow he changes my heart and I am free and I never want to go back to that life again. But it becomes because you're poor in spirit. You're not like the proud Pharisee that says, I can handle this, I can do this. And through self-discipline, you will your way to do good deeds, thinking that those good deeds is what will save you. Blessed are those who mourn over their condition, for they shall be what? Comforted. So what does God want from us? He doesn't want a lot of rules and regulations and a lot of religious good deeds. And he just wants you to come to him and be broken. And he'll take care of the rest. The deception of self-righteousness, I put there in your notes, self-righteousness blinds you in two ways. Number one, self-righteousness always compares yourself to others. That's one way that self-righteousness blinds you. In fact, let me scroll ahead a little bit here. Luke chapter 18, verse 9. He also told this parable to some people who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and viewed others with what? Contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. And the Pharisee stood and was praying this to himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other people. Wow. A little stuck on himself, isn't he? But see, this self-righteous pride, the blindness of self-righteousness comes, number one, by comparing yourself to other people. I don't do that. I don't stoop that low. I'm better than that. And then secondly, self-righteousness comes by a focus on your good deeds. I fast twice a week. I pay tithes of all that I get. And this was feeding this Pharisee's self-righteousness. He couldn't even see how desperately he needed God's forgiveness. And see, salvation by works, salvation by merit, by salvation by good deeds, it focuses your heart on the externals. And you don't see the condition of the heart, the internal. And the tax collector, standing some distance away, he was unwilling to even lift up his eyes to heaven. Look at this body language. This man was truly ashamed. He was embarrassed. He was broken. He was beating on his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Verse 14, I tell you, this man went to his house justified rather than the other. How contrary to this culture is this? This past week, one of the things I was doing Monday and Tuesday is I was supporting this leadership summit. And they had all the big wigs in, and the CEOs and the senior executive leadership. And I want to tell you something. In the corporate world, at least, it's cutthroat out there. I remember years ago, I was in this meeting with the CFO. And the CFO, he was saying, You know, what we got to do, we got to fire all the old people, get all of the old people out of here and get young college graduates because they're cheaper to hire. This guy is probably 10 years older than I am. So I'm sitting there saying, okay, old man, you first, right? We live in a performance-driven, performance-crazed world where if you don't produce, you're out. And that was one, that was a lot of the comments, you know, people giving their advice. They had a Wall Street advisor, expert in, telling them how to run the business. And the whole crux of it was this: if someone's not producing, get rid of them. Get someone in there that is producing. Now, from a business sense, that sounds kind of right, right? That's not the way God operates. It's not based upon your performance. It's based upon your heart. If you get your heart right, God will take care of the performance. But everything in our culture is so performance-driven. That's why we have all the backbiting and the gossiping that we have, because everybody's so afraid they're going to get fired, so they've got to fault find and pin blame on you before someone pins it on them. And so there's all of this turmoil internally, because it's all about image. It's all about appearance. And if you don't look just right, if you don't talk just right, if you don't dress just right, you're out. You're not worthy. And the scriptures make it very clear. I have the scripture in here somewhere. God doesn't look on the outside. He looks where? On the inside. Those are his standards. And so much of our relationship with God is based upon what we experience out in the world. And it's not that way with God. We better learn how to discriminate and distinguish between the two worlds. And we better start living our life according to God's standards. Because he looks on the inside. He looks at your heart. He doesn't want you to perform and fix it and clean up your mess. He'll do all of that. All he wants you to be is honest and sorry. How many of you think this morning, I can be honest? I can tell you everything that's wrong with me. I can be needy. I can tell you how much I need you and I can't do this on my own. I can do that. And he wants you to come to him in that way. But the deception of self-righteousness by the good works that we do. And a lot of times the good works are good works, but the problem is after the good work, we get proud about it. And we start trusting in the good work instead of trusting in the blood of Jesus. We start comparing ourselves to the sinfulness of others. Look at Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. The heart is more deceitful than all else. Boy, it will twist the facts of the matter and cause you to believe something that's wrong. The heart is desperately sick. Don't take this out of context or the wrong way, but I believe every one of us is mentally ill to one degree or the other. Sin has perverted us. Sin has vexed us. Lord, how we need our minds to be renewed and restored to God's way. The heart is more deceitful than all else. Who can understand it? 1 Samuel 16:7, God sees not as a man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. That's what matters to him. The outward will all pass away, but it's the heart that lives for eternity with him. The absence of self-awareness. It's really hard to look at ourselves. You know what it's like to see yourself on video? And you look and you watch and you think, do I really look like that? Ooh, do I really sound like that? Do I really act like that? At first, it can be horrible, right? Because we all have in our minds this pre-drawn conclusion of, no, this is what I really am. This is what I act like. This is what I sound like. And then when we see reality in the video camera, it's like, oh my gosh, I look stupid. I sound stupid. And so it's really hard at times to get clarity in that vision of ourselves. A.W. Tozer said this, the most godly Christian is the one who knows himself best. And no one who knows himself will believe that he deserves anything better than hell. Isn't that the truth? How well do you know yourself? I'm not talking about self-knowledge or self-awareness in a conceited or selfish way. I'm talking about being aware of your faults and your limits. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 9, just a couple examples for you. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen and the fatlings and the lambs and all that was good. Remember what God told Saul in this situation? He told them, kill everything that's breathing. King, peasant, soldiers, women, children, animals, don't leave one thing alive. And the people didn't obey. They were not willing to destroy them utterly. But everything despised and worthless that they utterly destroyed. And so here they are after this battle, a great victory, but yet they didn't do the commandment of the Lord. And so Samuel the prophet comes walking up to Saul. What does Saul say? Hey, Sam, I have carried out the command of the Lord. What? And what does Samuel do? I'm hearing all these sheep. What's up with these sheep? These sheep, dead sheep don't sound like this. The lowing of oxen, which I hear, you didn't do what the Lord commanded. Saul said they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep. Well, so it's now the people's fault. The people spared the best of the sheep. But the rest we have utterly destroyed. Okay, so the whole destruction part, God, I was doing the thing right. I was there destroying, but the people spared the best. Do you see how we can twist? We can justify anything in our minds. Our minds is one of our worst enemies. And like that passage said, our mind is sick, and it will lie to you. The absence of self-awareness, of not knowing your own failures, not knowing your own tendencies. Remember when a year after the sin with Bathsheba, and the Lord sent Nathan the prophet to David, and he gives him this parable. There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich men had great many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he bought and nourished. That was Uriah and his wife. That's what that symbolizes. And it grew up together with him and his children. It would eat of his bread and drink of his cup and lie in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. And then a traveler comes along, and he's unwilling to take from his own flock or his own herd to prepare for the wayfarer. Rather, he took the poor man's ewe lamb and prepared it for a man who had come to him. So he stole the poor man's only lamb. Verse 5, then David's anger burned greatly against the man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, surely the man who has done this deserves to die. And David in that moment had no idea he was talking about himself. Can you believe it? Now I say, can you believe it? And yet we've all been there. We've all done it. We don't see it. We don't see our own blind spots. We don't see our own frailties and weaknesses. We don't see how we're grieving the Lord. It's got to be a supernatural illumination by the Holy Spirit. He must make restitution for the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no compassion. And then Nathan says to David, you are the guy in the parable. You did this. And David's reaction was right. He said, I've sinned against the Lord. But how blind, the absence of self-awareness. 1 John chapter 1, verse 6 says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and we do not practice the truth. And remember, walking in the darkness in this context is keeping things secret. You want to cover up your behavior. You want to cover up your sin. You don't want anybody to know. You want to somehow spin it or twist it so it's not so bad after all. Verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Get this in your thinking. We said it a few weeks ago, but it's something we have to always remind ourselves. The sin doesn't separate you from God, but hiding it does. God wants you to come clean. If we walk in the light, If we're not hiding anything, if we confess our sins and confess our weaknesses and confess to Him, I can't fix this, I need you to fix me. And we bring everything to the surface, out in the open, in the light, you and God, your fellowship with Him continues. Because it's not the sin, it's the covering up of the sin. And if you come and confess it, He is more than gracious to have the blood of Jesus cleanse you from all sin. That's how we live. If we say that we have no sin, like Saul coming and saying, I've done the commandment of the Lord. Like David not understanding that he was the object in that parable. If we don't see ourselves, if we don't search our own hearts, if we don't spend time in the presence of God, we're deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, He's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us. So how do we deal with our sins? We deal with them openly. We deal with them honestly. We even confess our faults one to another, as James says, and we pray for one another that we might be healed. And there's no shame, there's no embarrassment in that. That's how God wants you to handle the sin in your life. Remember Job? Job says, I hold fast my righteousness and will not let it go. I hold fast my righteousness. I am righteous. I don't deserve what's happening to me. Where is God? Why doesn't He do something? I'm better than this. I'm holding fast my righteousness, and I will stand on it. I will not let it go. There's nothing wrong with me. My heart does not reproach any of my days. I don't regret anything. That'd be nice to say, wouldn't it? How many of you have like 36 regrets in your life of things that you wish never came out of your mouth or things you wish you never did? Now look at Job. When I went to the gate of the city, when I took my seat in the square, the young men saw me and hid themselves, and the old men arose and stood in honor of me. The princes stopped talking and put their hands on their mouths. The voice of the nobles was hushed. You know, who was that guy, Hutton or whatever, Sutton? Or, you know, when he speaks, everybody gets quiet. For when the ear heard, it called me blessed, and when the eye saw, it gave witness of me. Because I delivered the poor who cried for help and the orphan who had no helper. And on, I put on righteousness and it clothed. Job was a little stuck on himself, right? And a lot of times we ask, why did Job have to suffer to this severity? Why do you and I have to suffer, go through trials, go through perplexities that we don't understand? God, why is this happening to me? Why does the pressure just keep getting worse and worse? What's going on, God? You know why God? God had to take Job to this level of suffering because this pride in him ran deep. And sometimes it takes a really deep pain to get to that really deep pride. And in our life, when you're going through something that's excruciating, listen, pay attention. There's something God wants to dig up out of your heart by the root. And He's having to go through this whole process to get you there. He says, I was a father to the needy. I broke the jaws of the wicked. So Job is doing a really good job selling himself, right? Then the Lord gets a hold of him towards the end of Job, Job chapter 40, verse 1. Then the Lord said to Job, will the fault finder contend with the Almighty? Let him who reproves God answer it. Directing that to Job. Then Job answered the Lord and said, behold, I am what? Wow, his tune changed. I am insignificant. You know, it's like watching skydiving from the ground or on TV, and you think, oh, that looks so great, just free falling. It looks so peaceful. And look, they're holding hands and going around in a circle, and that looks like such fun. I'm going to go do that. And then you get in the airplane, and the hatch opens, and you look down, and someone says, jump. You got a whole different perspective now, don't you? And Job had a whole different perspective. He said, I'm going to lay my hand on my mouth because from this perspective, I'm seeing reality for the first time. I'm not all of that. I'm insignificant. And in the light of His presence, I see all of my frailties and wrinkles and faults. He says, once I have spoken, I will not answer. Even twice, I'm shutting up. I'm not saying one word more, Lord. I've learned my lesson. Your presence has rebuked me. He says over a couple chapters later, verse 5, I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye seeth thee. Wherefore I abhor myself and I repent in dust and ashes. That's what happens when you get in the presence of the Lord. And you realize your righteousness is as filthy rags in His sight. We can't do anything right. Why? Because Paul says in Romans chapter 7, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. I know what the right thing is to do. The willing to do the right thing is present, but I can't do it. I can't do it without Christ living through me. I find then the principle that evil is present in me. Every time I try to do what's right, evil overcomes me, he's saying. It's got to be Jesus working in me. Jesus said, unless you abide in me and unless my life is flowing through you, you can do nothing. And so when we come to Jesus, we truly come to Him poor in spirit. We say, Father, I can't do this. I give up. And He's been waiting for you to give up for a long time, to let Him take over and begin to live through you and bear that fruit through you. But a lot of times we don't see ourselves and we don't understand. Whatever I touch will be tainted by the depravity of my flesh. And the only way my actions or words can be pure is if Jesus does it through me. But anything I do, it counts as nothing. So how do we get there? How does God break through our self-righteousness? One, He breaks through by encountering us. Times in worship, times in your devotions, times in prayer. How many of you have had those times, those special times, when the Holy Spirit falls upon you and you see how little you are, you see how insignificant you are, you see how tainted and how frail and how faulted you are? Have you had those times where you just see clearly, I've grieved the heart of God, I've just offended His holiness, I can't believe how I've offended Him? Have you had those moments? Isaiah had that. You know, Isaiah was called the Prince of Prophets. He prophesied of Jesus more than any of the other prophets. I think, if I'm remembering right, he stood and prophesied to 4 different kings. Great man of stature. And you take this Prince of Prophets, and in verse 5, we know what's going on here. He encounters the Lord. He sees the Lord high and lifted up. And because of this encounter, he says, woe is me, for I'm ruined. I thought I had my act together. But God's light has shined on all of the cracks and faults and failures in my life. And I see how destitute spiritually I am in myself. Woe is me, I'm ruined, because I'm a man of unclean lips. How did he come to this conclusion? For my eyes have seen the King. I would venture to say this. When you spend time in God's presence and in prayer, if you're not coming out devastated and humbled and your pride ripped apart, you probably haven't encountered the Lord. Because when you come in the light of His presence, that's what shows all of your darkness. Are you leaving God's presence convicted? Are you leaving God's presence asking for forgiveness? Are you leaving God's presence broken and contrite, being careful in everything you say and do? That's what that encounter does. But secondly, His Word works in us. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, for the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. That's why it's so important for you to devour the Word. Because when you ingest the Word and begin to digest the Word, it starts to work in your heart and it begins to reveal things about you that you never saw before. It pierces as far as the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. It's able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And it doesn't judge you by the external of how you dress or how well you performed. It goes deep into the heart to show you what's on the inside, because that's what God's concerned about. The Word of God has supernatural power to reveal yourself to you. We live the Word. We eat the Word. Like Spurgeon said, we read a lot of good books, but we devour. We live by the Word, because that's the only thing with the breath of God that's living and will expose your heart. There's no creature hidden from His sight, speaking of the Word of God, but all things are open and laid bare. When you see yourself in the mirror of the Word of God, boy, it really shows you to yourself. And then lastly, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. Remember that verse we read earlier, the heart is more deceitful than all else and desperately sick. Who can understand it? And without verse 10, you just throw up your arms and say, well, I give up. I'm obviously deceived. My heart is wicked. There's no way out of this. But look at verse 10. I, the Lord, search the heart. You can't know your own heart, but the Lord can show you your heart. You know how? I test the mind, even to give to each man according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. You know how God does it? By the tests and the trials that He places in your life. And one of our greatest faults is that when we get under the stress and when we get under the pressure and all of the uglies come out, we just dismiss it, thinking, well, that's just because I was under so much pressure. No, that was the real you showing. And God brought this test, and He brought the pressure, and He brought the stress to show you what was really in there, what needs to be cleansed. That's really you. Don't blame it on the stress. And so in these moments where either He personally encounters us, like with Isaiah, or in those times when the Word of God begins to expose our heart to ourselves, or in this situation, where through the tests and trials of life, we get a real good picture of who and what we really are. What do you do with those sins? How do we respond? We respond like the sinful woman that came to Jesus. We come and we throw ourselves at His mercy. We throw ourselves at the blood of Jesus. We lay our sins at the cross. We believe that the cross has taken that sin as far from us, as far as the east is from the west. We realize there's nothing I can do to clean up the mess or fix myself. God, I need Your supernatural intervention in my heart and mind. My mind needs to be renewed. My heart needs to be cleansed. The desire for this sin needs to be gone from me. And let God do it supernaturally. And don't rely on human methods and little gimmicks and fads. Let's get back to trusting the cross of Jesus Christ. Because there on that cross, your sin died once and for all. You don't need any gimmicks. Get back to trusting in the blood of Jesus. Father, we thank You for the work that You've done in our life. We thank You that freedom from sin comes from You and You alone. On the cross, our sin was put to death. On the cross, the torment, the power was broken. On the cross, the shame and the embarrassment was wiped away. You've done such a wonderful work. How dare we turn to humanistic methods? How dare we turn to psychology to apply a band-aid to heal us slightly? When You want to invade our heart and pull out the evil by the root. And You've done it all on the cross. Jimmy Swaggart said once in one of his sermons, the church has no clue how saved they really are. And that's true. We don't know what deep levels, how sufficient, how all-powerful the blood of Jesus really is. We believe that we have to introduce human methods to try to rehabilitate. When God wants to cleanse you from deep within, He wants to put that sin to death, and He wants to resurrect you in the holiness of God. Let God do it His way, His work. Let the cross of Christ have full effect in your faith and heart and life. Father, we ask that it would be so. We ask for a good, safe, peaceful afternoon. And for those that are able, bring us back tonight to worship you again. In Jesus' name, amen.